Said, I would like to thank the members of organizing committee for providing me this wonderful opportunity to speak on an interesting topic that is lumbar plexus block with ultrasound. I'll be showing more of photos and videos. Greetings to you all from Ruby Hall Clinic. Now, as we all know, we are in the era of site-specific analgesia and anesthesia. So if the surgery is limited only to one limb, why we should anesthetize the other limb? Nothing is free from side effects. So this is the basic thought as regional anesthesia is progressing day by day. We have already covered the anatomy. My good friend Himjyoti has covered it. Lumbar and sacral plexus block most often is with dual mode. The simple reason is as there are no vascular landmarks. We depend more on bony landmarks. Whereas when we look at other peripheral nerve blocks, maybe upper limb, lower limb, truncal, there we can get away with only ultrasound. But at least when it comes to lumbar and sacral plexus block, or maybe gluteal sciatic or subgluteal sciatic, most of us would like to use PNS as well. So first year anatomy, Hilton's law, the nerve which passes the joint supplies the joint. So yes, there are challenges with PNS alone. We end up doing lumbar plexus block mainly for high-risk patients, and it is always in combination with sacral plexus block. Now, what are the challenges? Now, you can see this is one patient where we have done a lumbar plexus block using Capdevila's approach, and the needle was passed, and already this part is nicely covered with Dr. Himjyoti. What I am trying to suggest is sometimes the needle may move obliquely. It may not be exactly straight. It may not hit the transverse process. Here you can see that very nice twitch at 0.48, and we could give the drug. Now, as we are giving the drug, there is again, the challenge is what level we are giving. We don't know whether it is L4, L5, L3. And another thing is when we don't get a response, we usually again redraw. So we spend a lot of time. Also, there is one dictum that we should not attach the syringe directly. We should always wait for, CSF, if there is any CSF coming in, or if there is any blood in the, tubings, so as to prevent inadvertent epidural spread, intrathecal spread, or, vascular spread. So these are the challenges with PNS alone. Now look at the sciatic block here. Here we have used Mansoor's approach, and 6 centimeter, 7 centimeter. Now we have struggled here with this block. Now I'll again show you this video from the beginning, because you can see here there is some amount of blood in the tubing. So this clearly shows that we have struggled here, and there was initially some blood in the syringe and blood in the set, and then we have repositioned it. So then we might have injured the vessel. Repositioning it, we may get a good twitch. Here you can see a nice twitch, a sciatic response, and we have deposited the drug. But we were always worried about local anesthesia systemic toxicity, because there was a vascular puncture, and we monitored this patient very closely. So there are challenges. So these were the challenges. And so people have moved ahead, and they thought, let me see with ultrasound what I can do more. The main intention of use of ultrasound is to improve our success rate. We do not wish to poke our patient. It should be a time-bound event. And second, we do not want to end up with any complications. So to reduce complication rate and increase success rate, where the basic drive for use of ultrasound. And there are three approaches which people are knowing. One is the trident approach, which nowadays hardly anybody is using, but I'll be showing you how it is done. Then second is paramedian transverse oblique scan, which was popularized by Karmakar. And in his next paper last year in RAPM, he himself has criticized his method, and he said that Shamrock approach is better. So if nowadays I have to do lumbar plexus block, I am using Shamrock approach. Whereas for sacral plexus, this is not a topic given to me today. Just to complete the list, it is Taha's approach and parasacral parallel shift. In my practice, I use Thomas Benston's parasacral parallel shift. Maybe one clip I'll show you if time permits. So why we need lumbar plexus block? Usually high risk patients, high risk for surgery, high risk for anesthesia. Most often we are having patients who are on multiple issues with respiratory and cardiovascular system, say patients with severe aortic stenosis, patients with severe mitral stenosis, dilated cardiomyopathy, patients with ILD, patients who are on BiPAP, in respiratory acidosis, impending sepsis. And as they are moving out of ICU, orthopedic surgeon will detect they need hip surgery as well. Now these patients are again shifted back to OT for hip. And whatever may be the age of given patient, we need to proceed. Because otherwise they are bound to bed, and it is very difficult for family to look after the toilet and everything. So fixing of hip is necessary. So we have to proceed. So therefore there is a role of lumbar plexus, and we do combine it with sacral plexus for all these high risk patients. Also it provides site specific analgesia and anesthesia. So nowadays, other surgeries also, we are using this block with or without catheter. And sometimes it is the last option in many of the high-risk patients. Oh, contraindications are common, we have already seen. So I'll be just playing one video, and you will see how we do it. So this is the lumbar spine. And you can see the sacrum, the L4, L5, L3, and this is the view from back. So there are the spinous processes, there are transverse processes, and you can see the position and the alignment. Now, where exactly how I do it with landmark is I just feel for the spinous process. And then in Capdevila's approach, I just move little laterally and I hit the transverse process. So here, if I have to show lumbar plexus will be situated where my marker pen is. So that is the position of lumbar plexus just behind the transverse process. So how I do it? So how I do it is I'll ask for a needle. I'll just show you. So we usually feel the spinous process and roughly around 4 centimeter lateral, or like with Capdevila's approach, we first hit the transverse process. We walk over it roughly 1.5 to 2 centimeters and we are in the lumbar plexus. We stimulate it and we get the twitch, that is the femoral twitch, and we deposit the drug. Now with ultrasound, the patient is always in lateral position. So here you see body of vertebra, and that's the position of lumbar plexus. Now here you see the transverse process is facing the roof. So that's the body of vertebra and the transverse process. So when we scan from our Shamrock view, the probe position is like this, and what we see is we also see the spinous process. We see the Shamrock leaves, which I'll be showing you. So it produces more or less like a thumbs up sign. The thumb is like of that of transverse process, which we see from above, and the body of vertebra, represents and it completes that thumbs up sign. So I'll be showing you again with ultrasound scanning. So now this is the scanning which I'll be showing you. So now here you can see this is the head end of the patient and this is the foot end of the patient, and the probe is placed in the flank area. So it is just above the iliac crest, and you can tilt the probe either cephalar, you can look into the pelvis, or you know, more into thorax side. So this tilting, that is tail up tail down maneuver, is done to achieve a very good thumbs up sign, that is the shamrock view. So I'll just zoom in the camera and I'll show you how what are the structures. So here you can see you know, we are using a curvilinear probe. Here the depth is around 9.2 centimeters, and here you can see nicely the transverse process first. So here I'm drawing a transverse process for you. That's the transverse process. Then you have the body of vertebra. So now this is like a thumbs up sign which we see. So that's the thumbs up, and then we look for the shamrock leaves. So first leaf of shamrock is that of psoas muscle. So this is the psoas muscle, and within the substance of psoas muscle, as we know, is the lumbar plexus. So that's the psoas muscle for you. In front is, you can see the some movement with respiration. There can be kidney which tends to move, and lower down you can see IVC or aorta, depending on the side of the patient. On right side it is IVC, on left side it is aorta. So as we are talking about shamrock leaves, so first leaf we have seen in front of transverse process, that is anteriorly, is the psoas. On the top of transverse process is the quadratus lumborum muscle, and behind from where, you know, our needle usually comes with Capdevila's approach, it is the erector spiny muscle. So these are the three leaves: erector spiny, quadratus lumborum, and psoas. Now when we do it in a, you know, the Capdevila's approach, where our needle will come, our needle will come like this. Now needle will pass through the you know, erector spiny muscle. It will hit the transverse process, and around 1 to 1.5 centimeter ahead, we will see the lumbar plexus. It will, and we'll get the twitch, the femoral quadricep twitch is the end motor response. So we are using dual mode. Now you can appreciate that you know, the lumbar plexus is not very distinctly seen. Why? Because it is a deeply situated structure, one thing. So it is in the substance of psoas muscle. So where exactly in the substance of psoas muscle? It is at the junction of anterior two-third and posterior one-third. So here is the lumbar plexus. And but still there are many more white lines. So what are these white lines? You can see these white lines. So these are intramuscular tendon within the substance of psoas muscle. So they also appear hyperechoic, and you think that this can be lumbar plexus. So it is always desirable to use dual mode. So now once the needle is passed, we have approached at the level, and then we can stimulate it. Now I'm just showing you the vascular structures around. The first vascular structure which we can encounter, now since this is right side, we can see IVC in front of body of vertebra. So this is IVC which is in front of body of vertebra, and also you know, it is a deep seated block, and there are lumbar arteries and veins. So it is good idea to put Doppler, to put color in that area as well. I'm just showing how we do needling. So when we are doing it with Capdevila's approach, you can see the point of entry for Capdevila's approach. So we have a spinous process line, then the line passing from the, you know, PSIS, and then the intercrystal line, and then medial two-third, lateral one-third, then that's our point of entry for Capdevila. Now if needle has gone through this, then we have to make our probe really oblique to see the needle. Now whenever probe is made oblique, the needle visualization is always challenging. So if you are doing ultrasound guided block, and if you are going ahead directly, then probably the needle entry point would be this, we do not wish to go much cephalad because there are issues with kidney on right side. So it is just maybe, you know, little one level or one space, 3-4 centimeter above. And as we pass the needle will come directly, you know, we can just move the probe so that we can get rid of transverse process, and we are working in the intertransverse process area. Needle will come directly and it can reach the lumbar plexus. Now, what is the advantage of using ultrasound? Now, the advantage of ultrasound is when we pass the needle, first is it may hit any vascular structure, so we can change the trajectory. Secondly, the needle may tend to move obliquely, and you know, it may go anywhere, so we can see the tip of needle where it is moving, and we can control it, so we can prevent complication. Also, it increases the success rate. Once or twice it has happened with me that I was using a Capdevila's approach, like how we pass the needle, and there was no twitch. Then when I placed the probe, I found that the needle has moved more laterally. So sometimes, you know, you can see your needle going laterally. You think that you have passed the needle in a straight line, but needle has moved laterally. So I have just repositioned the needle looking with the help of ultrasound, and I could get a twitch. So these are the advantages where in real time we can see the needle. Also, if we place catheter, we can see the tip of catheter. As we inject the drug, we also see the movement of drug. And before injecting drug or before passage of needle, we must always put a color and check for lumbar vessels. It could be lumbar artery, lumbar vein, and then we can even change the needling, the trajectory. And this is very useful. There are incidences with local anesthesia toxicity. There are incidences with hematoma formation. So this is the one block which we would like to avoid in patients with borderline coagulation issues. So we have to be careful. Now, another important aspect other than, you know, the Shamrock view, which the two other views which I would like to show you, these are not commonly practiced views, but you should have some idea about how these are being done. These are technically challenging. So what this is, I'm showing you the Karmakar's approach, and here the probe is moved in paramedian transverse oblique. The probe is insinuated inside. So it is paramedian transverse, and then it is turned little docking mechanism. So turned inside. So paramedian, transverse paramedian and oblique. So I'll just show you on the screen how it looks. So first we start from midline. So as we start from midline, what we see is the spinous process, the lamina and the transverse process. So this is a transverse scan of lumbar vertebra at L4 level. We can always count vertebra and we can identify exactly which vertebra it is. So this is the spinous process, that's the lamina. So, and that's the transverse process. So now we have to concentrate more on the transverse process. So now here the orientation marker preferably is kept laterally so that we all the time get the similar image and we are used to that sort of pattern. So I'll just show you the probe movement. So probe movement is like, you know, we are here in the midline and we tend to move little laterally and then we make it oblique. So here, as we are moving laterally, and it is an oblique view. So here the transverse process, instead of straight, it has, you know, it is in the oblique plane. So because of the transverse process, we cannot see anything below. So it is casting a black shadow down. So that's the transverse process, which is obstructing our view. Now I'm coming back here on the patient. I'm just showing you the probe position. Here, what the movement I'll be doing is, I'll move my probe either cephalad or caudad, so that I can work in the intertransverse process area. So either cephalad or caudad. So now I want to get rid of that transverse process. So I'll again show you there. So now you see the transverse process. Now the transverse process is casting a black shadow. And now I am moving my probe cephalad. So now there is no transverse process. So there is no transverse process. So now the area has opened up, which is the intervertebral groove area. Now I can see body of vertebra. I can nicely see body of vertebra. I'll just mark it for you. This is the body of vertebra. This is also known as S wave pattern. And that's the lumbar plexus in front of body of vertebra. So I can move my needle. I can move my needle from posterior to anterior side, the way I do it for, you know, the Capdevila's approach. So in the similar fashion, I can pass my needle. I'll just have a needle. I'll show you. So more or less, you know, in the similar in plane technique, or else you can go out of plane technique. You can be close to the transverse process, move over it. But of course, as you go in plane, you can actually avoid hitting the transverse process here, and you can do it. Now I'll just mark the lumbar plexus there on the screen, and I'm turning my probe 90 degrees. So I'm turning my probe. Now this is the trident view. So already the marker on my screen is on the lumbar plexus. So I am aware of the depth. And now what you are seeing is the trident of Shiva, or these are the transverse processes which cast black hypoechoic areas. And in between the two transverse processes is the substance of psoas muscle. So again, the psoas muscle, medial, the anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3. At the junction, you will see the lumbar plexus. Here the arrow is pointing towards the lumbar plexus. Now I can actually put, I'll freeze the image. I'll freeze the image for you, and I'll put a marker. So I'll put a caliper, and I'll calculate the distance from, you know, the transverse process and the lumbar plexus. So how far beyond the transverse process I have to travel. So it is roughly, here you can see one point. So I'll just ask. So it is 1.41 centimeter. So I am aware that once I get the transverse process, I will have to travel at least 1.41 centimeter ahead to get that lumbar plexus. But this approach is not commonly practiced because we don't see many structures as transverse process is causing hindrance. Now, little bit modification, or you know, some technical advancement with shamrock view. So as we are doing here the shamrock view, sometimes we approach our needle, we put our needle from antero-posterior direction, from anterior to posterior side. Now, what is the advantage of this approach? Now, with ultrasound, we see everything. We know where the kidney is. We know where the other muscles are. So the advantage of this technique from going anterior to posterior side is we can do a transmuscular quadratus lumborum block plus lumbar plexus block in the same settings. So here I'm identifying the anatomy for you. That's the transverse process again. Then we have body of vertebra on the tip of transverse process. We have the quadratus lumborum muscle, and in front of transverse process, we have the psoas muscle. Now needle will come from anterior side. So needle will come from anterior side. So you can see the needle. Now it is deposit, the drug for transmuscular quadratus lumborum block or QL3 block is, you know, the interfacial plane between the quadratus lumborum and the psoas. Ideally, the drug has to be deposited between the epimysium of quadratus lumborum and the thoracolumbar fissure. So once that drug is done, that QL3 is done, I can withdraw my needle, I can move my needle to lumbar plexus area, and I can do a lumbar plexus block with the help of PNS, and I can finish that block as well. Now, why we wish to combine these two blocks? It is for complex hip surgeries. It is a very useful technique with redo surgeries. Now, I'm just showing a very small, tiny clip to show our modification with sacral plexus block. Now, sacral plexus block, Taha has described his approach, but what I'm showing you is Thomas Benston's approach of parasacral parallel shift. Now, parasacral parallel shift, we palpate for greater trochanter and the posterior superior iliac spine. Then we join that line. Then we identify the midpoint and we drop one perpendicular. Now the probe is kept medial to this midpoint. So the line joining the PSIS and the greater trochanter, probe is kept medial to this midpoint. And this is parasacral shift. So you have to move the probe up and down. Now, very often the movement causes a lot of disturbance. So we just tilt the probe. This is one of the modification. And by tilting also, you can get the same result. So you can see the screen now where you can see a straight white line. Here my orientation marker is lateral. So the lateral part is the ilium, the medial one is the ischium. And when we tilt the probe, this bone tends to break. So we see a greater sciatic notch here. So that's the ilium bone. Above the ilium here, we have piriformis, and above is the gluteus maximus muscle. Now you just see the movement of probe over there. I'm just trying to move the probe. So in one view, I'll request to have it in one view. Look at the probe movement as well as the screen. Here on the screen, you can see the sacral plexus is seen nicely. The bone has, you know, the sciatic notch is now visible and you can see. But as I'm making my probe oblique, it is very difficult to do needling in plane with an oblique probe. So I do out of plane technique for this block. Now the important thing for this block, as I turn the probe, is to identify vessels. So it is always good idea to put Doppler in this area. And the what we see is on the medial side is the inferior gluteal artery. Inferior gluteal artery and vessels, and also the sacral component we have to confirm with PNS. So it is again a dual mode. So here I'm just trying to identify the inferior gluteal artery on the medial side. If we have to do an in-plane technique, then probably I would like to move away from this artery, and my needle will come in this direction. So it is from probably medial to lateral side, so that I do not end up hitting the vessel. So that is all about sacral plexus, and it is a very useful technique. Dose reduction has happened with use of ultrasound and with our better knowledge with cadaveric studies. Nowadays, Dr. Sandeep Diwan is doing lumbar plexus block with as low as 9 ml. The overall trend with a lot of research coming up with low concentration, less use of adjuvant, more use of continuous catheters, fast tracking, and in program intermittent boluses. Where are we now? So we use modest volume. Most of us use still 20 to 25 ml and 0.3 to 0.375% ropivacaine or levobupivacaine. We for post-op analgesia, it is always 0.2 ropin. Perineural dexa or IV dexa. Dexamethasone is sparingly used because intravascular spread can lead to bradycardia. And mixing of local anesthetics, yes, some centers do practice. The use of lignocaine adrenaline serves as a vascular marker. And in the initial training days, we do require some amount of volume as drug spread is not very clearly seen with a curvilinear probe. And yes, we are with use of catheters and we have pumps with program intermittent boluses. So stock solution is prepared. It is either 0.375 ropivacaine. So we just double dilute ropivacaine and we use LOX with adrenaline either in separate syringe as a test dose, or we can, you know, add to the stock solution, and roughly 20 to 25 ml for lumbar plexus and 20 ml for sacral plexus. Use of continuous catheter and, you know, it produces very good analgesia, and 5 centimeter beyond the needle tip for lower limb and 3 centimeter beyond the needle tip for upper limb is the dictum. And placement of catheter and tip is confirmed with ultrasound by injection of dye as well as air bubble. And we do have this program intermittent bolus function. So we do not use continuous infusion and say 90 minutes every 90 minute 9 ml bolus. This has been found to reduce local anesthetic requirement, local anesthetic sparing effect, less of motor blockade. And there are literatures with various peripheral nerve blocks with program intermittent boluses. And this is one of the research area and recent advances in this field. Thank you very much for your kind attention.